A very good afternoon to all present. I'm Riya Rathi, founder and director of latestlaws.com. I would like to welcome you all on behalf of Team Latest Laws and also thank you all for your participation in today's Lexidem webinar on the topic, What Ails Our Criminal Justice Delivery System? The webinar is being telecasted live on Latest Laws Facebook page as well. The viewers can send in their questions via question answer portal visible on their screen. They will be taken up at the end of the session. Today, we are highly privileged to have with us Honorable Justice S.M. Dhingra, former judge of the Delhi High Court. Lordship has also worked as member of the Competition Commission of India and chairman of the Review Committee under Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. He has headed many inquiry commissions and panels. Government appointed Justice Dhingra as one-man commission of inquiry to investigate alleged irregularities in grant of land licenses to companies. Presently, he is chairman of the special investigation team set up by the Supreme Court to probe 1984 riots. He is an avid social worker. He is chairman of Justice Gopal Singh Public Charitable Trust, running charitable dispensaries, OPDs, and education centers for children of weaker and poor sections. We are very grateful to you, sir, for sparing your time and joining us for today's webinar.
Thank you. Now
I would like to request Lordship to commence his address.
See, the today's topic is what ails our criminal justice delivery system. If I have to explain in one word and tell in one word what ails our criminal justice delivery system, the one word will be inertia. Inertia is, you see, a law of science where things remain in the same position unless an external force is applied to change the position. So our criminal justice delivery system is suffering from inertia as no one is taking responsibility of changing this system. Neither the stakeholders. In this case, the stakeholders are judges, advocates, litigants, legislature, prosecution. But unfortunately, all these stakeholders are suffering from an inertia and actually have no idea as to how to change this system. See, I shall start with the judiciary because judiciary is one of the main reasons of the inertia in this system. If judiciary can single-handedly move this system from present paralysis to an active system which provides justice to the common man. Today, the scene is that common man is at receiving ends. He is compelled to approach the courts as there is no other avenue for him to seek justice. Especially in criminal cases. If we see the working of the courts, we find that our superior courts are very busy in dispensing judgments in PILs to the rich people, to those who have power. You can buy the time of our superior courts by engaging some senior advocates whose fees, if you have capacity to pay, would ensure that you will get hearing in the court. You can wake up the court at midnight and compel the judge to hear your case even at 12 midnight. But in case of a common man, we have not heard that the court woke up at midnight or at any other odd time in order to deliver justice. This I am talking of superior courts. In case of our trial courts, they are not inferior, let me say, because I am talking of High Court and Supreme Court as superior because that is the common terminology. But I do not consider any court as inferior or superior. They are all courts with one solemn duty assigned to them of delivering justice. And I consider each court, whether of trial court or at High Court or Supreme Court, they are responsible only for one thing, that justice should be delivered. They are all equal with different duties and responsibilities. That is what the legal status of the courts is. But unfortunately, we call our trial courts as subordinate courts. They are in no way subordinate to anyone. They are independent and they discharge their duties to purely independently. The superior courts, so-called superior courts, have different responsibility of going through the judgments of our trial courts and only vetting them whether it was according to law or not. Thinking that the judges at superior courts have more experience and more knowledge of law, which many times is not true. So I am talking of judiciary, how judiciary is responsible for the present situation where justice delivery has taken a back seat. See, our judges at the trial court are not properly trained to deliver justice. Their training is more how to handle cases. We are bound by a procedure which is not amended from time to time. Judges at High Court and Supreme Court keep giving faulty interpretations which stand in the way of justice delivery to the various laws, including procedure laws. Whereas procedure laws should not be subject matter of changes, because if you keep changing the procedure, the judges at the trial level will never know what the law is. That is why it is always considered that the courts at High Court and Supreme Court should not interfere with the interpretations too often, unless there are compelling reasons that the law has gone wrong. But in India, the beauty is that for each case, each law, you have judgments on both sides. Even for procedural laws, you have judgments on both sides. And these are exploited by the advocates to the fullest. Therefore, the intervention of the legislature is necessary, that the legislature should lay down the law in a clear, categorical manner. I remember of a recent judgment of Supreme Court in narcotics trial cases. Earlier, the law was that if an accused is found in possession of certain quantity of narcotic substance, by the substance is sent to laboratory and the quantity is determined by the percentage of narcotic substance present in that quantity. If your substance is 10% pure, the quantity would be considered as 1/10. This was the law laid down by Supreme Court earlier. Recently, the Supreme Court has changed the law and it has held that the total quantity would be considered as a narcotic substance irrespective of the percentage. Now, these kind of interpretations require judicial intervention. The judiciary, the legislative intervention. The legislature at the very initial stage, when the Supreme Court had earlier stated that the substance would be considered by taking into account the percentage of purity, should have intervened and should have clarified whether the total substance is to be taken into consideration or the only percentage-wise substance is to be taken into consideration. These examples can be multiplied. Unfortunately, the courts do not take into account the previous judgments seriously and keep changing the judgments at their will. Under these circumstances, the trial courts are faced with tough choice. They have to decide which judgment to be followed. Many times, the judgments are not even overruled and they are allowed to remain and stay. So, the courts have that prime responsibility to ensure that law is fixed. This is what is taught to the law students, that law is fixed and every citizen is supposed to know the law. But unfortunately in India, the law is not fixed. Neither the citizens can be sure of what the law would be tomorrow. So I was talking that judges have prime responsibility of justice delivery. Judges have failed at highest level and not at the trial court level only. Now at trial court level, we have three kinds of trials: summary trial, summon trial, and session trial. The procedure for these trials is not laid down precisely and in clear-cut manner. Today we are living in a world where different and innovative methods are used for trial. We are living in digital world, cyber world, and the crime is committed with the help of tools which were unknown to the previous regimes, previous legislature. They never thought that this would be the scene of crime. Now, the responsibility lies on the judges to ensure that justice is delivered and the procedural law is interpreted in a manner to take into account the present methods of committing crime. But this is not done. Most of the time, judges are at loss how to handle the case and they keep at giving adjournments. This shows lack of training. If the judges are trained properly that how to handle new situations, how to handle new cases, how to handle different kinds of cases, I think even the trial court judge can handle each and every branch of criminal cases very efficiently. Our training system is not only faulty, but it lacks substance. We just teach old judgments delivered by High Court and Supreme Court. We do not inculcate a habit in the judges how to innovate, how to handle situations which are unheard of. We do not present before them the situations taken from previous trial court judgments, how the trial courts handled different cases and came to and delivered justice efficiently. The other problem with our judiciary is their attitude. Judiciary is not trained at least what I know from the training of judges, they are not trained to wake up to the situation of the litigant, to be sensitive to the cause of the justice. They continue to deliver judgments in old-fashioned method, and they act more like babus than like judges. I can surely say that hardly 10% of the strength of judicial officer is concerned with the woes and pains of litigants. And 90% of the judicial officers, they act like babus. They are not concerned with the pains. They are concerned only with one thing, their career. They are career oriented, and they only look that their units should be complete. Now, every judge has to give some monthly quota of units, and then their effort is that their units must be completed within that month. So, in that effort, they try to do away and they try to put aside those trials which need time, which need energy, which need more reading. And they try to conclude only those trials which are easier to do. And the result is that all tough trials, they remain pending. And this results into delay in justice services. The other reason for delay in justice delivery system is that our judges are too afraid of the bar. They are taught from the very beginning that you have to cooperate with the bar. You have not to annoy the bar. With this thing in mind, they try to adjust the bar at all costs. They give adjournments at the wish of the bar. They do not bother that witnesses have come and they are waiting for their call. This is true not only in respect of defense advocates, but it is true in respect of prosecution. See, even in case of petty offenses, where you say that police person has wrongly challenged you for speeding or for jumping red light, and you had not jumped it. If you contest, you may have to appear in the court for 6 to 10 times. And the person who was present there, who had challenged you, who is witness, may not appear in the court on one or the other reason. He may say, I am busy. Now the court will not consider that the person who has appeared in the court has also left his work. This happened with me personally. When I was an advocate, I was challenged for overspeeding. My meter did not show that I was overspeeding. So I told, I'm sorry, I had not overspeeded. I will contest. See, I appeared in the court 6 times without the policeman appearing with the record. So at the 6th time, I said, told the judge, you are wasting my time. Please have this fine, which was hardly 50 rupees. I was not contesting for 50 rupees. I was contesting for the right cause. And for that right cause, you have wasted my 6 days. So I paid 50 rupees and came back. So this is the fate of all persons which are facing petty offenses. That is why in all petty offenses, people prefer to pay fine instead of contesting the, even in those cases where the policeman or the inspector has wrongly challenged. So that is one reason that which shows that our procedures have not been properly laid down. The procedure should lay down that for how many times you can call a person in petty offense. How many opportunities you can give to the prosecution to produce a witness. When you have to close. So all this in case of petty offenses must be laid down. Similarly, in summary trials also, procedure must be laid down. The procedure in summary trials, petty offenses, in summon trial, and in session trials have not been clearly laid down. A witness is summoned innumerable times at the call of the defense counsel. Or a witness is not called because of the laxity of the prosecution. And that results into failure of the trial. If a witness is not called, there you are leaving the witness to be won over by the other side. And if a witness is repeatedly called, you are harassing the witness. So that is how the courts are functioning today. Now this is the sole responsibility of the judge to ensure that he does not give adjournments. CRPC has been amended. CPC also has been amended. It has been provided that busyness of advocate is no ground for grant of adjournment. But unfortunately, our judges, our advocates, public prosecutors, they do not follow the changed law. Judges do not bother the number of adjournments being given by them. Otherwise, there is no reason that a trial runs for 25 years. There are cases in India, criminal cases, which are running for 25 years. Then we must also provide that a judge who starts the trial must end the trial. Either he must not start the trial, he should fix his procedure, fix his schedule in such a manner that by the time his transfer is due, he does not take up a new case. He does not start the trial. But whatever trial he has started, he must end. And there should be time limit provided for ending the trial. We often see that high courts and Supreme Court in various cases where powerful persons are employed from time to time keep giving instructions that the trial must be finished within this period. And the recording of evidence must be day-to-day basis. Why this cannot be provided in the law itself, by the legislature, that once a trial starts, it must come to an end within this period. You delay the starting of trial, but once the trial starts, it must come to an end within that period. And if it is not finished that period, the judge shall be considered incompetent. But our procedure is not there. Our session trials run for years together. Summon trials run for years together. See, bouncing of check, which hardly needs any trial, runs for years together. So, the judges are suffering from inertia. They do not want to change. legislature is suffering from inertia. They do not want, the legislature doesn't want to change. The advocates have no reason to cry for change. Litigants, poor litigants, they are unable to unite together and pose a front or create a lobby like women's lobby or advocates lobby and force legislature to make changes and to create new laws so to meet the situation. That is one reason which I find that the judge is not taking responsibility. Legislature is not taking responsibility, and the superior courts and senior courts are not at all willing to take responsibility. See, there we could have easily solved this problem of speedier trial just by adopting one method, just by taking one course of specialization. Today, we are living in an era of specialization. You find in all fields, there are specialists. In engineering, you find that it has many branches. If you go, see, even in solid state engineering, you will find it is further subdivided. In chemistry, the biochemistry, you have further specialization. In medical science, you have specialization. You have heart specialists, you have super heart specialists. You have within the heart, you have only valve specialists. You have only stent playing specialists. In orthopedics, you have specialists who can replace hips. You have specialists who are specially replacing knee joints. So people are going towards specialization. But judiciary has not gone for specialization. And unless we choose a method of specialization, the judicial system is not going to improve. Neither our justice system is going to fasten up. Today, what is happening is that when we look at the High Court, in High Court, the 66% appointments are done out of advocates. Now, out of those 66%, these advocates come from various branches of law which they have been practicing. Somebody is practicing taxation, somebody is practicing property rights, somebody is practicing intellectual property rights, somebody is practicing only civil side, somebody is practicing service law, somebody is practicing labor laws. And once they are introduced into High Court as High Court judges, they become expert of every law. They are made to sit in a division bench for 2-3 months just to know how High Court functions. Thereafter, many of them and most of them are given independent benches. And strikingly, they are not given the bench of that law, that branch of law, from which they have, on which side they have been practicing. If you have been practicing on service law in the same High Court, it would be considered you will have many friends and advocates who are specialized in service law. So it is better not to give you service bench. So you are given criminal bench. You have no experience of criminal. You do not know ABC of criminal law. It is not that by reading CRPC at the time of LLB or by reading few judgments at home, you become a master in criminal law, or you become a criminal law expert judge. Each branch of law has niceties, has various inroads which you need to understand. But unfortunately, these judges, neither at high court level nor at Supreme Court level, are given training. And they get on-job training. And how they get this on-job training? They, by handling the bench. The change of roster is done so speedily in various high courts. See, in some high courts, the roster changes after every 6 weeks. In some high court, it changes after 3 months. In some high court, it changes after 6 months. Now, with this change of roster, you will find that each high court judge normally handles a new roster after change of roster. It is sometimes the same judge, the judge is given same roster again. But this depends upon his adjustment with the bar also. If the bar is not happy with the judge, they will go to the Chief Justice and get his roster changed. This I have seen practically in Delhi High Court, where bar used to dictate which judge should be given what roster. And the roster used to be changed if the bar was not happy with the judge. So, this kind of training, on-job training, does not make you a specialist. Unfortunately, our High Court judges and Supreme Court judges are considered specialists in each branch of law, which is not true. They cannot be specialists. Why we cannot have specialized courts where criminal court starts from the trial magistrate court and right up to Supreme Court, only those judges are appointed who have all along been doing only criminal trials and only criminal cases. The judges, advocates who are picked up from criminal, those who are handling criminal cases, should be appointed in the criminal benches of the High Court. Or the judges from the trial court who have been specialized in criminal cases handling should be appointed as High Court judges. But unfortunately, this is not done. The criminal cases are given to those judges who have been handling income tax cases. And the result is that we have completely mismanaged criminal justice system, and the law is at the mercy of, I would call, in novices and nosakhiyas. When these judges at high court and high court level handle criminal cases and they are not from criminal branch of law, they actually get on the job training and they do not deliver judgments during their tenure of the roster. And by the time they learn somewhat law, their roster changes and they are thrown into a new law branch. So that is how our courts function. When our courts function like that, can you expect justice? Can you expect criminal justice system to function? You find that is why you find that our laws are unsettled so often, so quickly, that litigants, trial court judges, and the high court lawyers, they are at baffled. That what is this? Law is totally unsettled. You find that in our courts. You see, even in Supreme Court and High Court, the when arguments take place, the judgments are cited by both sides, justifying their position of law. It cannot be that the law, the position of both sides can be justified by the judgments. The judgments must settle the law once for all. But today in our country, the beauty is that law is totally unsettled. See, I remember of a judgment delivered few days back. See, earlier in narcotic cases, the law was that the percentage of the narcotic substance is determined and the accused is sentenced on the basis of total pure narcotic substance present in the quantity seized. Recently, the Supreme Court changed the law by a judgment and it has held that it is not the percentage of the narcotic substance which is to be taken into account. It is the total quantity of the narcotic substance, irrespective of the percentage. If you have 10 kg of a narcotic substance containing 5% of the real narcotic substance, you will be suffering the same sentence if you have 10 kg of the narcotic substance having 100% purity of narcotic substance. So this is how the law has changed. So this kind of change is brought because by the judges, because our legislature keeps sleeping. See, it is not only lack of training of judges, it is also the sleepiness of our legislature. Our legislature does not step in at the right time to crush the law. Legislature keeps sleeping, thinking that judiciary shall take care of itself. So the law is not fixed. The first quality which a law student is taught, quality of law which is law student is taught in the colleges, that law is fixed. Law is known to everyone. But in our country, law is not fixed. And that is the reason that each case, howsoever insignificant it may be, can be dragged up to Supreme Court by the advocates who have good face value at the Supreme Court. And they can always twist the facts and tell the Supreme Court that law is not laid down. And it is not laid down clearly because we do not believe in laying down the law clearly. So I was that our judicial system, our systems and our courts are not specialized courts. I was talking of specialization, that if we have specialization, we have exclusive criminal court. Right from the bottom till the top, this situation will not arise, that one judge will hold that the percentage of the narcotic substance matters and other judge will hold that it does not matter. So this kind of justice delivery system where judges are not trained in the branch of law in which they are to deliver judgment. They are not trained basically with the basic law. Then this difficulty arises. See, we train our magistrates for 1 year and judicial academies. And then they are given online training, on-job training for a few days when they are made to sit with the senior judges. But this is not true of High Court judges. They are not given any training either in any branch of law. It is considered that their 10-year practice, which is the minimum requirement for being appointed as High Court judges, is good enough training for making them expert in law. But from my personal experience, I can say that 10 years at bar is nothing. You do not learn the niceties of even one branch of law if you have spent 10 years at bar and you are still a novice. I can understand if we have different branches, specialized judges in different branches of judiciary, and they for 10 years continuously are handling those kind of cases, they are well-trained judges. But if you are 10 years as an advocate practicing different laws, and in the beginning every judge, every advocate starts practicing on different sides for first 4 or 5 years, he only is trying to find his place where he should work, which branch of law he should start practicing as specialization. And after 10 years, as the luck may have, he can be appointed as High Court judge. So you may have a totally illiterate judge as a High Court judge, I may say. And you may put in his hand the life of people, the life of those who have come for appeal or revision before him. I remember a case where there was a mistake in mentioning section by the trial court judge, and the High Court judge had never done criminal trials. So he sent back the case only on the ground that there was wrong mention of section instead of saying that this is a typographical error and it can be corrected right here. So this is no ground for appeal. But so this, the problem is that we have not evolved a system where we have gone for specialization. Today, we are living in an era of specialization and super specialization. Why we have not taken our judiciary to specialization and super specialization? Why a judge? We do not have a criminal branch of the judiciary where judges start as magistrate and end up as Supreme Court judge. Why do not we have a revenue branch of judiciary where judges start as civil judge and end up as Supreme Court judge? So that is, we have not bothered to reform our judiciary. We have, you see, the legislature is fearful of reforming the judiciary because I find that since 90s, judiciary has become super powerful and legislature has been losing its power as far as judiciary is concerned. From 90s onward, we find that you have judgments on all sides, and that is why you can twist the law and you can have judgment on either side. So I was talking that we must have specialization, specialized courts. If we have specialized criminal courts, the trial will take less time. A judge will know the law better. It is not that after every 3 years, his branch of law is changed. You can start with magistrate. He will have trial of offenses which involve less sentence than as the magistrate class one. He will have trial of offenses with sentence up to 7 years. And then session judge, where you can give award sentence up to life and death sentence. Thereafter, you can elevate these judges after their experience to High Court and Supreme Court. You will have, if you want to introduce and induct fresh blood at all levels, there is no bar. But the condition must be that the advocate must be practicing exclusively on criminal side. Then similarly, we can have specialized courts in all branches, and we will not have contradicting and conflicting authorities. Today, the judicial scene in India is that you have contradicting judgments, contradicting judicial authorities, and law is not settled. The main effort of the advocate is to take advantage of this unsettled law. With the law getting unsettled, remaining unsettled, the beneficiary is the criminal and the advocates. The loser is the society and the victim. And that is what is happening. Now, we do not have any time period fixed for criminal trials. Criminal trial can run from few months to few decades. You must have recently seen that the Supreme Court has fixed a time period that the trial of demolition of Babri Masjid must be finished within this period. Now, how many decades have already passed of that demolition of Babri Masjid? Now, this is the case is at trial stage. After trial, it will go to High Court. And after High Court, it will go to Supreme Court. I know of a case, Lalit Narayan Mishra murder case. The murder took place in 1975 or 73, and when I was district judge in 2005, the case was at the stage of defense evidence, and I left as a district judge and was elevated. The case was still running at the stage. On every hearing, I used to get a new order of High Court and Supreme Court that this witness is to be examined or this is not to be examined. This interference in the trial by the superior judges is due to their ignorance of the trial court procedure and due to the fact that they are free to interfere in the cases they choose. There has to be certain checks and balances on the superior courts that they cannot interfere in the trial at all levels. If they have to interfere, they must interfere at the final stage and not at every stage. Unfortunately, in India, the law is interpreted in such a manner that you can ensure that a criminal trial runs for 50 years. And this is what was happening in case of Lalit Narayan Mishra murder case. When I left it, the trial had already lived 30 years of life. And I don't remember how many years more it lived. But I know that final decision has not yet come. So you can see that we are in 2020. And that crime took place in 1973. Now, 27 years plus 20, 47 years have passed. And the case is still going on, a criminal case. And it is not one single case. Lalit Narayan Mishra was a known person, known minister. His trial took this much time. There are many trials which are lingering on because we do not bother about the justice. We bother about the procedure. Why we cannot ensure that a trial must finish within a time period? You see, if you remember, a trial of bounce check in Delhi and in other places in India used to take years. A trial of petty offense takes years. It is surprising that this happens in India, that we have taken our judicial system for granted, that we can twist, turn it in the fashion we like. If you have money, you can take even a petty case up to Supreme Court. If you have money, you can take 145 CRPC case right up to Supreme Court. So that is how this judicial system works. And why this works so? Because we do not have specialized judges. We do not have judges who, right from the day one, are trained in one branch of law. And right up to their retirement at highest level, they keep dealing, they become specialized and master of that branch of law. We have specialization in all branches of, see, medical science. We have specialization, fortunately, in judiciary. A judge, a advocate, income tax advocate, is admitted as a high court judge, and he may hold criminal bench on the next day. So this is why that our criminal justice system, and I will say all systems, civil justice system, revenue justice system, they're all suffering. We do not have one fixed law. Whereas, as a student, every one of you is taught that one nature of the law is that it is fixed and known to the citizen, so that citizen can conduct themselves according to law. But in our country, the law is not fixed. The citizens use law as a gamble. That is how our entire system functions. Yes. Any questions?
Thank you, Lordship. So this brings us to the question answer segment of the webinar. We would now take some questions from our audience. So, one of the questions asked by attendees is that our jails are packed to the capacity. 70% inmates are under trial prisoners. World UTP average is 22%. What is the solution to this problem?
See, one solution is increase in number of jails. Of course, since there we have less number of jails and more criminals, so the jails should be appropriately increased. Second is that we should innovate. Our entire system must be innovative. We must, in case of petty cases, we must introduce a system where the person is trusted. He is given probation. More often, probation is given and his conduct is watched. He is allowed to improve. Today, probation is very rarely used and we do not give probation to a lot many people. And therefore, our jails are full. Second, other reason of jails being full is that trials take too long. Under trials, they are full of under trials also. Not only criminals, 75% population of jails is of under trials. And our trials take too long time. A trial which should finish in 3 months normally finishes more than 3 years. I'm talking of petty offense cases. I remember an experience, my own experience. You see, I was challenged for speeding. My speedometer did not show that I was overspeeding. So I asked the court that I was not overspeeding. So I will contest. I appeared in the court for 6 hearings without the policeman appearing. Ultimately, I said, sorry, you cannot waste my time. So this, the judges must be alive, not only to the time of the prosecution, they must be alive to the time of litigant who comes before them. They must be alive to the situation that punishment is not only the purpose, improvement is also the purpose. You can use probation law very often and encourage people to admit the petty offenses and go on probation or on penal fine, mere fine. Even in those cases, which are those crimes which are committed in the heat, the stance taken by the judges must be different from the stance taken in other cases. This, see, criminal law gives ample discretion to the magistrates and to the judges to give punishment appropriate to the situation. See, normally our punishments are up to 3 years, up to 5 years, up to 7 years. Minimum punishment is prescribed only in few offenses. See, they are in those cases where corruption cases are there, minimum punishment is there, or narcotic substance cases are there. Minimum punishment is there. But in all other cases, violence cases, minimum punishment is not there. So, minimum punishment is at the discretion of the judge. Giving probation is at the discretion of the judge. So, judges must be alive. They must be properly trained in what cases they should give probation. Unfortunately, our judges are not trained properly. And we do not have a specialized criminal branch of judges where they get online training for 1 year or 2 years and they become trained. And thereafter, for lifelong, they are on that. We care more for change of their taste. You see, for every 3 years, we change our judges. And we give them from criminal law to civil law so that their taste changes. Or they learn more law. Why we do not go for specialization? This is time of specialization and we must go for specialization. That will result in quick decisions and equitable decisions.
Yes, sir. So the next question is regarding availability of competent legal aid for poor accused. So, sir, are you satisfied with the quality of the panel lawyers of legal service authorities?
You see, we do not have proper legal aid system in us. Normally, those advocates enrolled for legal aid who have no work and no experience. It should be, you see, our legal aid system should be made in such a manner that every experienced lawyer should be obliged to handle few free cases. Otherwise, this should be the first condition of granting lessons. And the judges should have discretion to assign legal aid cases to all lawyers and watch their performance in legal aid cases. If they are not attending legal aid cases, their lessons should be cancelled. The poor are now being left at the mercy of those liars who do not know law. Why we cannot have well-trained liars also for the poor? See, the untrained liars are not meant for poor. Poor are not the training ground for the untrained liars. Training must be obtained by liars with the senior advocates, not by practicing practicing their law free or on legal aid advocates. And I have seen this, that you see the Supreme Court, I know of a case where Supreme Court looked down upon legal aid advocates very poorly. This case has been handled by legal aid advocates. That is why it is. I think Supreme Court must change its attitude. In that case, I found that the Supreme Court judge himself was not knowing law. He was not knowing ABC of criminal law and was commenting on the legal aid liar. Because legal aid liar has given up some of the witnesses that they were not required to be cross-examined. And actually, they were not required to be cross-examined because they had not deposed anything against the accused. But unfortunately, the Supreme Court judge was not knowing criminal law in that case. And he made remarks against the legal aid liar. But we must have this law that legal aid would be the duty of each and every advocate practicing in the court. He would be bound to take some cases of the poor people, those who cannot afford good debt. And the report would be taken from the court, should be taken from the court where he is appearing as a legal aid, whether he performed his function properly or not. That is, otherwise his lessons should be cancelled.
Another question asked by an attendee, Sonal Khurana, is, can community service be used as an alternative to imprisonment in jail for less grave offences?
That is what probation is. Actually, probation can be coupled with community service. See, probation, we have provision for probation in our criminal law. Now, this can be further coupled with community service. Some judges of their own, see, have been taking initiative, and in case of probation, they have been directing some persons to go to the hospital, to go to some places and do some service. But not under any particular law of their own. So to tell in order to take benefit of the services of the person, for the betterment of the community. But this can be done. This is not done as per any set procedure, but law can be changed and this can be done.
Yes, sir. So the next question is, the same public prosecutor handles cross cases. Is it proper? Public prosecutor handles cross cases. Is it proper?
Public prosecutor handles cross cases.
Yes, sir.
I don't think it is proper for public prosecutor. Public prosecutor must only handle public cases, private cases, and not private cases. And no permission because they handle these cases. You see, every state has different procedure for appointing public prosecutors. You will find that with the change of government, the public prosecutors change in many states. If today you have Janata Dal government, the public prosecutors will be different. The moment the government changes, the public prosecutor will change. So this, the manner of appointment of public prosecutor should itself be changed. Public prosecutor must be made public servants. In most of the states, public prosecutors are appointed for tenure on tenure basis. They should not be appointed on tenure basis in trial courts. In I would say even in high courts. Today, public prosecutors in high courts are appointed on tenure basis and on party lines. This party line appointment of advocates is highly difficult. You see, I would say it is not required. But this is happening. We must have public prosecutor. And that is why you will find that public prosecutors, the moment government changes, the cases are withdrawn, the public prosecutors change, they move applications for withdrawal of cases. And the new public prosecutor has his own philosophy. New government has his own philosophy. The law does not change with the change of government. But here, the law is made to subserve the government. And that is why, you see, our criminal justice system is not functioning properly. You can run a case as many years as you like.
Yes. So the next question is, who is to be blamed for high acquittal rates? Police, prosecutor, hostile witnesses, or judiciary?
See, I would primarily say judiciary is responsible for higher acquittal rates. See, it is. I will give you an example. See, when I was working as a judge, as a session judge, my one colleague was also working as a session judge. And a kidnapping had taken place in Delhi of a businessman. Businessman was kept at Panchkula as a hostage and ransom was being asked. Police chased the telephone calls and ultimately he was rescued from the criminals. Criminals were arrested. Now the criminals were very powerful persons. If you have heard the name Mukhtar Ahmed Ansari, he was one of the UP dons. He was the kidnapper. And the kidnapped was one businessman of Delhi. Now the first thing he did after arrest of all the whole team group was arrested by Delhi police from Panchkula, where they had kept the criminal. After the arrest, the first thing he did was to move an application for this identification plate. Now the trial court was a judge, magistrate. He knew that identification plate is not required in this case because he was a magistrate, he was conducting trials. So he dismissed the application because the accused persons have been living with you. It is not one often, one case of a meeting where you have met the accused. You have kept the accused for so many days. So there is no need of identification. The accused, the victim in that case was kept by the accused for about 1 week, accused person, in Panchkula. So he dismissed the identification page application. Then they went to session court. Unfortunately, the session judge was a recently newly appointed judge who had been practicing only on civil side and had never practiced on criminal side. So the session judge allowed the application. Now the jail, that person was so terrorized even in the jail that he said, I can't identify. The person who was kidnapped. I'm not able to identify. Because these people, you see, Mukhtar Ahmed Ansari was a known criminal at that time. He had contacts outside also. So the man was terrorized. He did not. But there was ample evidence of commission of crime, even if the person has refused to identify. The person was, you see, these persons were caught red-handed. They had kept the accused in a rented accommodation in Panchkula. The accused was liberated from them red-handedly when they had brought the victim to telephone booth. In those days, there was no mobile phones. There used to be only these phones, landlines. And they used to bring the victim to telephone booth for making call to for ransom amount to his relatives to please arrange this much. So the entire evidence of his being kept at a place, his being brought to telephone booth, his being rescued from that house, his being rescued from right from the telephone booth, house being ransacked by the police who had taken to see later on Talashi of that house. Now, entire evidence was there. Only on the ground that this man said, I'm sorry, I'm not able to identify them out of 10%. You know how identification rate is done. 10% of equal height and etc. are kept, made to stand in a line and the victim is asked to identify. Now he, out of fear, refused to identify at that time. Now this accused person moved an application before the trial judge. And unfortunately, the trial judge was also a novice session judge who had never done criminal cases. And they made an application that accused me, examined as a first witness. So the accused was examined and the accused again did the same thing. In the trial also, he said, I'm sorry, I cannot. Without examining any other witness, without examining police officers who have rescued him, without examining the telephone department when the telephone was kept on their watch, without examining the landlord from whom that house was taken on rent by these persons, and without examining those police officers who had kept watch over that house for quite long period of 1 week in order to rescue that man from the clutches of kidnappers. See the judge close the trial. So that is how, see, our criminal justice system is malfunctioning. Totally malfunctioning. We do not ensure that our judges are properly trained. The entry of judges is at lateral stages. You can, entry of session judges is there at, we have entry at magistrate level, then we have entry at session judge level, then we have entry at high court level, and then we have entry at Supreme Court level. And there is no wonder that a person who has not done ABC of criminal law as an advocate enters at session judge level and is given session court.
Yes, sir.
There is no wonder that a person who has not done criminal law throughout his life enters at a high court level judge and is given appeals to trial. So that is why our entire criminal justice system, and I will say entire judicial system, is suffering. People are suffering because we do not have an appropriate judicial system.
Lordship, the Supreme Court has recently in its order suggested decriminalization of check dishonor cases in which the checks are of small amount. So what is your opinion about the same?
See, how you can distinguish between check of small amount? And it means rich people can always, you see, go to Supreme Court because bigger transactions take place between rich people. The poor people is left at the mercy of the somebody. See, why should you make distinction between rich and poor? You are otherwise also, you see, our trial courts, our jails are full of under trials who are poor people. Our rich people are not under trials. They may commit any crime. They are not under trials because they manage bail at one level or other way. That will be making distinction, setting two set of norms for poor sufferers and rich sufferers, for poor people and rich people. That is not what was envisaged at the time when Constitution was written. That was not envisaged by the, you see, criminal law, justice system. Criminal justice system cannot function differently for poor and the rich.
Thank you, sir. Because of paucity of time, we'll be just taking one last question. What are the concrete steps which you think that should be taken to improve our criminal justice system?
We should stop inducting judges of different branches of law in criminal law at different levels. That can only ensure the speedier criminal justice system. That we should start from magistrate, keep them promoting as session judge, senior magistrate, metropolitan magistrate, session judge, high court judge, and supreme court judge. If you have to make lateral entries instead of promotion, lateral entries at different level, only enter expert criminal advocates. Expert criminal advocates for criminal trials. Then only you can have a good, smoother, better, quick criminal justice system. Today, our criminal justice system is at the mercy of the person who may or may not be knowing law. A judge, it is not that each of, once you are Supreme Court judge, you become expert in everything. See, that is why the arguments keep going for months together. And books are read, and the judge is still at loss to know what is the right law and what is wrong. See, if you have handled criminal law right from as a magistrate up to Supreme Court, you will immediately know what is the question involved and how it can be taken. You will not come on one day and surprise everybody that, you see, narcotic substance should not be considered by the percentage and the total quantity should be seen. If it is 1000 kg, having only 1 kg of narcotic substance, you will punish him for 1000 kg, not for 1 kg.
Thank you, Lordship. And if Lordship could shed some light on how to improve criminal investigation by police officers.
You see, it is a subject, again, we don't have our criminal investigation institutes. Our all training as of judges is online training, on-job training. You become a police officer, you are given 4 weeks training in a CFSL lab, 4 weeks training in another lab. This is how judges are trained. That they are sent for training courses in a CFSL lab, in a criminal, you see, in institute, in forensic science lab. And it is considered that they have become good criminal judges. or they have become good civil judges. They are sent to judicial academies for, you see, 10 days course or 1 week course, which they consider as a paid leave. Attend lectures without, you see, seriousness and come back, okay, after going to Bhopal and other academies. So this is not the manner in which any judicial system can be run. That is why there, you see, our conviction rate is so less. We should have a system where judge at the time of framing charge may say, sorry, no charge is made out. This is very petty offense. I won't waste my time on trial. I give him liberty to go home. If it is, you see, a cycle theft is tried more seriously by court today, magistrate court today, than the theft of a car, because the car person can manage a good advocate who will keep taking dates, but a cycle person who has stolen a cycle cannot manage an advocate. So you see, the gravity of crime must be seen from the eyes of a common man, not from the eyes of a judge. See, a common man considers for him whose cycle has been stolen is as serious for another person whose car has been stolen, maybe less serious than the theft of his cycle. Because the person, only proper way of conveyance with that man was cycle. And this man is having 10 cars with him. But we are giving more seriousness to the car theft than to a cycle theft. So we must look from the eyes of a common man. If we see from the eyes of a common man, we can perhaps manage our judicial system in a much better manner.
Thank you, Lordship. Thank you so much for joining us for this session. It has certainly been an enriching experience, really. And I would also like to thank Indian Dispute Resolution Center, NorthCap University, and Vivekananda Institute of Professional Studies and Ansal University for their support. Thank you to our viewers for joining in. With this, we would like to wrap up this session. Stay at home, stay safe. Thank you. And once again, thank you so much, Lordship.
Thank you.